house with us.
Yeah.
Here at MTV Rap Fix. And before we bring her out, I just want to take you guys back into time to see Lil Kim when it all began. This is when MTV has covered her career from the beginnings. We found this clip from Yo MTV Raps, and I want to play it for you guys. Lil Kim is up next. Check this out.
Look what I'm getting ready to purchase. Aha, you don't got one, I got one, you don't have one. It's a chinchilla. Yeah, gonna get it today. Yo, I'm doing my thing at Saks Fifth Avenue, New York. I can't believe it. Do you see all these coats? And I get to take one home today. That's right, y'all. And guess what? We're getting ready to bring you my latest. Yo, this video was the bomb, y'all. Y'all don't understand. Me and Puffy was doing our thing like this. No time for fake ones. We was doing our thing. Man, we was backing each other up. And guess what? We're going to give it to you right now. So sit tight, y'all. Here it is. No time for fake ones. Just sit some good style with these real ones. From East to West Coast, spread love, son. And while people's all done, we count fake ones.
Yes, yes. Lil Kim, ladies and gentlemen, the woman who has truly earned the name Queen B for the past 15 years. She's been a beast on the mic. She's been an innovator, and she's mastered the environment of being relevant in the streets, but also on the pop charts. Get the game today. She's so relevant. She's still one of the top topics in today's conversation. Welcome to Rap Fix, the Queen B herself, Lil Kim, ladies and gentlemen. Good to see you. I'm doing well. Have a seat. Man, you smell good. What is that?
Thank you. It's oils. My grandmother makes them for me.
Your grandmother makes oils?
Yeah.
Where's she from?
The South.
What part of the South is she from?
Like North Carolina.
Okay. Well, you smell good. She might want to bottle that up.
Yeah, thank you.
This is actually our first time sitting down and having a conversation.
Yeah.
So it's an honor to finally meet you officially.
You too.
And sit down and talk about your career and all the things you have going on today. You got a lot going on today.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
It was pleasure to be here.
Did you see that clip we just played?
Yeah, it's cute.
What do you think when you see that?
It had a lot of fun. I just can look at it like that. That was the early beginning stages, having fun.
Mm-hmm.
So young.
How are you different from then to now? What's the difference of Lil Kim who was back then in the mid 90s to Lil Kim now?
I think then I was probably like all over the place, you know what I mean? And I think my moves out more carefully now, a little bit more responsible.
Mm-hmm.
I was very irresponsible at that
very
age with everything, with money, with life.
You looked like you were having fun though.
I was having fun.
Mm-hmm. I remember the first time seeing that No Time video. You know, I'm originally from the West Coast, so and I saw you with Diddy, and y'all was coming down the escalators, and you was doing your dance. To me, that kind of marked the beginning of a new era of empowerment, in a sense, for female artists. It's always been hard for female artists in the rap game. At that time, were you conscious of what you were doing?
I had no idea what I was doing.
Okay.
I'm gonna be honest with you. You know, I had no idea that little girl from the hood would even go that far. A lot of people don't even know. Like, when I came into the industry, I was so young.
Mm-hmm.
But because the content of my material was so mature,
mm-hmm.
I think the people who were behind me kind of just kept, you know, my age and all that kind of very quiet. So the people probably do think that I'm older than I am. But it's cool, you know. It gives me a sense of, you know, flyness, a sense of sophistication now.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, it was back then, it was for female rappers, I would think it was less common.
Mm-hmm.
But when I came into the industry, I guess I gave it such a different twist that, you know, I kind of made probably a lot of females who were very girly think,
mm-hmm.
you know, want to rap. So, you know, that's a good thing.
And I think you probably made them not just want to rap about what would be considered girly things.
Right.
You know, when you first start putting out your music, what did your mother say? How did she respond to your lyrics?
I remember we were on a talk show where she said, "Oh my goodness, I wish I would have took that child to church more often." I remember she said that. It was one of those talk shows like Ricky Lake or something.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone was just laughing. But she learned to appreciate the music and understand it. And, you know, as I grew, she, you know, there was certain music that she could like really, like one of her favorite songs was Light Is Up and Computer Love that I just did recently. Like, she's like, "Oh yeah, these songs, I could get with these songs," you know, so it's like, you know, like my fans, she grew with my music. That's cool.
Okay, that's cool. We're gonna take we got so much we could talk about in one interview, so we're gonna try to squeeze it all in.
Yeah,
okay, so
we're
gonna,
cool.
That's cool, all right? We're gonna go to our first Twitter question. It's at MTV Rap Fix. If you got a question for Kim, send it right now. Let me see. How does it feel to know after 15 years you're still relevant enough to have so much success again?
I mean, it's just, I guess it's a blessing. No, I know it's a blessing. You know what I mean? It's a blessing. Trust me, it's very hard to do.
Yeah.
It's very hard to do. And, you know, you have to be very strong in order to survive. Mm-hmm. Not only this long, but also as a female in this industry, you know? I can't wait till people who are in this industry, especially like a lot of females that are in the industry now, when they get to this stage, you know, very few make it, you know what I mean? And very few can kind of say, you know, it's been a while in the industry and they still have, you know, a place like, you know, Missy Elliott is very special in this industry. And, you know, I would like to say people like even Lauren, even though she's been missing, but I mean, all it takes is for her to, you know, she has that type of power to me. I don't know, that's just to me.
She's only one hit away. A lot of people would say that up until recently about Kim, like, where's Kim been, you know? Yeah. I know the story, you know, and I've even heard you speak about it, but talk about, if you don't mind, what your time has been spent on after you got through service. Serving time in prison.
Yeah, well, after I came home from prison, it was a long, tough, rough road. When I came home, I refused to record from my record company, which was Atlantic Records, and I think it was just, you know, differences. We were on a whole different page when it came to my career. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they've had me since a baby, as they would say. So, you know, they kind of thought they knew me, and they didn't know me very well. So I refused to record for them for about a whole year. I went to Hollywood and did my Hollywood thing. Mm-hmm. And they thought I was playing. They were like, "Oh, she'll be back. She's just mad." And, you know, they admitted that they made some mistakes. And, you know, they wanted to kind of make it up and do a whole new album. But I was just nervous at that time. You know, I had been in the career. I mean, I had been in the industry for a minute. And, you know, I take my career very seriously. So I kind of just wanted to kind of, you know, seek help in other directions where people would understand who I was and the direction I wanted to go with my music. So for like a whole year and a half, 2 years, you know, my record company realized I wasn't going to record for them. So they were like, "Oh, she's serious," after a whole year. And after that year, they said, "Okay, what is it going to take?" And, you know, but we couldn't, there was nothing that they can do at that point. So they decided to let me go, but they didn't let me go. I had to pay them.
You had to pay them?
I had to pay them. I mean, because let's just keep it 100%. Like, I was a major part of keeping the lights on in the urban department and at my record company. So, I mean, they weren't going to make it easy for me. You know, I'm like, that's like so much money walking out of the door for them.
You were franchised for them. But how did you, when you weren't recording, how did you make money? What ways did you?
Well, I did my Hollywood thing, you know what I mean? And, you know, I'm blessed. That's all I can say. So many opportunities fell in my lap. And then I, like 2 years after that situation, because I've been home now for what, like five years, something like that. So 2 years after that situation, I struck up a deal with Trackmasters, who is a very known producer and production
group. Tone of Polk, Rich Tone Nice,
Polk.
Polk.
Yeah. And I grew up with them. They're like big brothers and uncles from around my way. So, you know, I knew them for a long time, and we decided to do something together. However, that deal went sour, and for a whole another 2 years, I was bind to a contract with them as per the courts. Like, I was going back and forth to court with Trackmasters because they sued me.
Mm-hmm.
They sued me, and the reason being that they sued me was because I didn't want to go through with the deal with them anymore, because we were supposed to have a partnership, and it ended up, you know, not being that way. So I was a little bit sore about that, because I left Atlantic Records to go in a whole other direction. Mm-hmm. I didn't leave Atlantic Records to go in the same direction,
yeah.
You know. So we kind of just didn't see eye to eye in the direction either. So, but I'm happy to say that we're very good friends to this day. I mean,
okay.
Business is business, you know what I mean? And,
mm-hmm.
you know, we got over that part of it, and I you probably will hear music with myself and Trackmasters, and maybe an up-and-coming album or something like that.
I want to ask you about serving time. That isn't easy for anyone. We
mm-hmm.
all know somebody, if not ourselves, that served time. What was probably the lowest point in that stint for you? And then what was it that you took away from it?
When I first got to prison, I slept so good for the first 3 weeks.
Oh, did you? Damn, I ain't never heard
that. I slept good, because you know why? I had to... I was working for the whole, that whole 2 months before, nonstop,
mm-hmm.
trying to finish an album, doing promo, doing the TV show, which was the BET television show that
mm-hmm.
I did, doing shows, doing all type of things. So I never slept, never rest at all for 2 months straight. I can't even say there was one day I had off. As a matter of fact, I know there wasn't one day that I had off. So it's when I got there, I just kind of just collapsed, like, oh, well, I'm here. I can get comfortable, whatever, but not that I can really get comfortable, but I was greeted with open arms by a lot of, like, wonderful, wonderful girls in FDC, Philadelphia. I met a lot of good people in there who are still my friends to this day.
Okay.
I walked through the door. They made me a feast. You know, we were in the Fed, so certain things we do, and they made me this cake, chocolate cake out of, like, Oreo cookies, and a Jolly Rancher high heel shoe on the top of it.
That's great.
It was the cutest thing I've ever. That's the one time in prison. I wish I had a camera
mm-hmm.
for that moment to take that picture. But there was a lot of love there. You know, you always have your haters no matter where you go. You can't escape that, especially when you're somebody.
That's true.
And you're, you know, very important and people love you. So, you know, that was that. But, you know, I think the most down moment for me,
mm-hmm.
it wasn't even New Year's, it wasn't Christmas, it wasn't any other holiday except for Thanksgiving.
Why
and
was that?
I don't even know.
Yeah.
I don't know. And, you know, I saw more people be more down during New Year's.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't understand that, because I'm like, girl, don't be down. That's a whole other year gone. You in a new year, you know, close to going home. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of how I looked at it, you know.
So we're going to get into this mixtape, okay?
Yeah.
This mixtape, boy, I tell you, you know, this
yeah.
is
it's
a lot going on. Huh?
Yeah.
Okay. And let's start with an exclusive. We promised people, and you provided us with an exclusive. So we're going to play a piece of audio from this one track, and you could talk to us about it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Here you go, Rap Fix. Let's go.
Lamborghini turns into Megatron. Got him blue in the face. Avatar. I be shooting on him. Diarrhea. You bitches looking burnt. Gonorrhea. Same bitches throwing shots. Just trying to be a. I guess it's all politics. Condoleezza. I'm the first lady. Her Majesty. Rap's royalty, bitch. Now you work for me.
Hey. Well, okay, that's the Nicki Minaj beat, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what do you call the song?
I don't know if I can say it.
Well, beep yourself. Edit yourself.
It's an on them.
On them? Okay.
Yeah. Not the front. Not the back, but the front.
Okay. Not the back, but the front. Okay. Let's talk about this. I mean, I know if I may, you know, we've kind of talked about it a
mm-hmm.
little bit, and stop me if you don't want me to go into it. I'm okay
mm-hmm.
with that. You
mm-hmm.
know, first of all, I told you I would apologize to you,
uh-huh.
okay, for something we discussed off air, and so I'm apologize to you if I gave you the wrong impression of me and how I feel about you. So I want to do that live and on air because I told you I would.
No, I appreciate okay? that.
Oh, that's all good. I'm a stand-up dude.
A real man, y'all.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk about this project, mm-hmm. you know, and the fuel behind it, mm-hmm. you know. At first thought, I'm a fan of yours.
Thank you.
Okay? And I'm a fan of Nikki's. Mm-hmm. I would say that. And there's a lot of people mm-hmm. who are fans of both of you, mm-hmm. you know. You're the first. Mm-hmm. And you've accomplished so much in this past 15 years mm-hmm. that I think even Nicki Minaj and other mm-hmm. girl artists mm-hmm. have watched your moves and been inspired by it. Mm-hmm. But this is the first project, really, that you released in mm-hmm. a long time. Why take this route?
Why take this route?
Yeah.
Let me put this in a really good way. If somebody smack you, right, what did your mama tell you to do if somebody smack you in the face?
You smack them back.
You smack them back. That's the only way. That's the best way I can put it. Mm-hmm. I don't know how some people can see it as if, you know, I started. I don't get that because mm-hmm. I've been chilling. I was laid back. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? The shots came my way. Mm-hmm. What am I supposed to do? What would you do? Put yourself in my shoes. I was chilling. Mm-hmm. You haven't heard nothing from me, have you?
I've heard some crazy records, you know, some crazy songs.
Yeah, but I'm talking about before she did what she did.
Prior to that, I think mm-hmm. it was all up in the air. People mm-hmm. were speculating. There was a lot of metaphors being used lyrically. But on a bigger picture, I mean...
But lyrically, where? Where like did you hear me do any music before she did what she did? Mm-hmm. Where did you hear me do anything? Nothing. I didn't make any music before she did what she did. Mm-hmm. I was chilling.
So
then when she went on Angie Martinez, that was it. Enough was enough. Mm-hmm. But so much somebody's going to take. What you going to do? What would you do?
Well, that's
and then on top of all of that, you just stole my style and just run with it. And then, you know, you just throwing shots at me. And, you know, you just, you know, basically not even acknowledging that you are a fan mm-hmm. or that you have... you know, or that you are idolizing me or whatever it is. That's a beautiful thing for somebody to envy you and want to be like you. I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. I think that's beautiful. But the problem that I have is that, you know, love is love and it should be shown in front of the world. And you should also show the person that you admire how much, you know, of influence they may have had on your life. That's not just in music, but that's in anything. Mm-hmm. You know, I did an interview recently with this guy, and he said to me, well, you know, Kim, you know, everybody borrows from everybody. Yeah, but borrowing is just what it is. If I borrow your scarf, aren't I supposed to ask you or get permission from you or, you know, or see if it's okay. If I just take it, then I'm stealing it, especially if I don't acknowledge that it's yours. Mm-hmm. That's all. But that's not the basis of this situation. My basis of this situation with homegirl is deeper than just paying homage. You know, I don't understand how people say, well, come on, how many times are you supposed to pay homage to you? Come on, let's just be real. This is not what that's about, you mm-hmm. know? If people do their homework, I did a song with her and Baby.
Yeah. It's
supposed to be for Baby's album, okay? And he never put it on the album that originally went out, the one mm-hmm. that, you know, was the first CD.
He told me about the song,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so he never put it on there. And one of the main reasons being is because after they had put it on iTunes, a lot of people were like, oh, Kim killed it, Kim this, Kim that, which I guess kind of overshadowed her. And my thing is, hey, you know what I mean? You're going to get that in the industry. You know, just, you know, keep going, whatever, do you. And for a lot of people who don't know, I was over in the presence of Cash Money. You see how we chilling?
Yeah.
I used to chill with them the same way. The same way. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I never, unfortunately, got to run into her over there, but I ran into Wayne a couple times. I was always there with Baby and Slim and a couple of other guys from the group. So basically what I'm saying is we were going to be alliances. I was going to be a part of that family. Slim and I were talking about some business ventures we were going to do together. I'd known Slim for about 4 years, mm-hmm. and we were friends for about 4 years. Mm-hmm. And during those 4 years, which was like right after I came home from prison mainly, we talked about doing some like a business venture together where they would kind of be my partners. Mm-hmm. And so think about it. It has to be deeper than just paying homage. Mm-hmm. If I'm over there, why, if I'm in your circle, I'm not going to come over there and start trouble with one of your peoples. You know what I mean? I came over here because I saw that they were trying to take her in a direction to kind of, you know, swaggerjack me, which is okay if, you know, you're going to acknowledge the fact and also, you know, not be throwing shots. She was throwing shots and, you know what I'm saying? I saw her out one time. Didn't say anything to me. Mm-hmm. I didn't understand that. And then, you know, still throwing shots in the media, on songs, you know, in interviews. I didn't get that part of it. And I even told Baby and Slim, I was like, look, you know what I'm saying? Just, you know, let home girl know it's okay. You know, she don't gotta be throwing shots. And Slim was like, yeah, oh, I'm gonna make sure that ain't happening no more. Okay, fine. But it kept going. Then when Baby snatched the song off of iTunes, mm-hmm. that kind of hurt because of the simple fact that I had been doing my Hollywood thing for a while. So I'm like, okay, let me go back into the music scene right now. You know what I mean? I'm a businesswoman. I'm a hustler first. I looked at Cash Money having this girl that they were so trying to so just completely imitate me. I looked at that as a way for, you know, me to open back up my own lane in the industry again. That's what a businesswoman would do. Mm-hmm. A businesswoman is not going to say, let me see if I can start beef with this girl because she's trying to be like me. I wouldn't do that. So
you have to know that the public is like, man, when does this end and will they ever come together and make an album together?
Well, see, that was my whole thing. The Baby promised, oh, we're going to do a video, we're going to mm-hmm. make it big, and then mm-hmm. we're going to do some other things together. And that was the whole basis of doing the first song. Mm-hmm. Do you get where I'm saying, where I'm coming from? Mm-hmm. The first song was supposed to be me, Baby, and her.
Okay, and that could have opened the door.
It could have just opened it, which we talked, you know, then it's going to lead to other things. And in my eyes, I already knew what I was going to do. You know, if that had gone well, I was going to be friends with her. Just to let her know, it's okay, Mama. You don't have to keep going the route that you think you need to go, the route that you're going. You know what I mean? But sometimes when females come into this industry, they don't have anybody in their ear like that. They have people in their ear like Baby saying, you know, you need to be the only one out there. You know what I mean? Like anything else is going to take away from you. We need to get you hot first. That's not how it goes, because I'll be damned if I'm just lay down. I'm not dead. They're like, what the heck? I don't get that.
So I want to continue this, okay, because I feel like I'm hearing in details your side that and you know that you don't often get a chance to hear in one piece,
right.
Okay? And then we're not going to make this interview mm-hmm. all about that.
Please
okay?
Don't. So much bigger things.
You've done so many big things in your career. Mm-hmm. And you've always been someone who has been in the forefront of being abstract with your style and creating your own movement. I want to go back to 2001, and I got all this footage, so I got to use this because I think it's interesting milestone moments in your career. Well, you can see your evolution. And in this clip, you talk about what makes a rock star. And at that time, rappers didn't see themselves as rock stars.
Right.
You know what I mean? Only one or two people kind of had that mentality. So let's take a look back to 2001.
My definition of a rock star is anyone who isn't afraid to be over the top, risque, a trendsetter, anyone who really takes pride in their work. And I mean that, like, literally. Fred Durst is a rock star. Madonna to me is a rock pop star. Michael Jackson, rock pop star. Myself, rock pop star. That's what they say, you know. I think I'm a trendsetter, so I definitely fit in that realm. And you know, I'm an entertainer, period. So I think a rock star, as an entertainer who's just not afraid to be themselves and go over the top.
Wow. That was you 10 years ago. You look like a baby.
Yeah, I was a baby. I told you. You can tell now that I really was a baby coming into the industry, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, I was so, you know, my music was so mature, so people mm-hmm. looked at it.
What is your definition of a, what makes a rock star today?
I think that girl right there said that very good. Mm-hmm. I think definitely just being fearless and living your life the way you want to live your life, you know what I mean? I think that's what makes a person a rock star, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Just being fearless and being over the top with whatever you want to do.
Who are some of the, like when you look at the now generation of artists out there that, and not, you don't even have to pigeonhole it to just rap. Who do you consider a rock star? Some of the new artists that are out right now.
I think that definitely Rihanna and definitely Lady Gaga. But Lady Gaga is so many things. I just love her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it can go on and on about, you know, people who are in the game now that are rock stars. On and on.
I mean,
I guess as far as the ladies are concerned. I like Wiz Khalifa. I like him. I think he's definitely he's rolling high. So he's definitely, I like him. I think he's dope. Who else? I like a lot of people.
That's good. You like Wiz Khalifa. You're definitely paying attention to what's popping right now.
I'm a Maroon 6. I'm a Maroon.
Maroon 5.
Maroon 5. Yep. Oh, yeah, my bad.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a Maroon 5 fan. Really. I love them. I've always been, and I like Evan Essence. So I listen to like different types of music.
Mm-hmm.
There's a new rapper too. I think I don't know if he's a rock star yet. I don't think he's really gotten that chance. But his name is Big Sean.
Big Sean.
I like him.
He's been on Rap Fix before.
Yeah.
Him, I like him. Sly High Prince. You like Big Sean?
I think he's dope.
We got a clip from Wiz Khalifa actually just talking about what he has coming up next.
Mm-hmm.
And he's changed a little bit about his appearance. I want to get your take on it, all right?
Oh, okay.
All right, Khalifa.
Nah, not really. I didn't feel any pressure to follow up on Black and Yellow's success because I know just... You know, when we put Black and Yellow out, it was just supposed to be like a lead-up single, and it had huge success. So with these ones that we're planning on doing great, I know that they should work at least the same. You know what I'm saying? So I don't feel too much pressure. I'm really, like, excited. Man, I'm really excited that Rolling Papers is dropping March 29th. I've been waiting to put an album out for a long time, but I feel like, you know, my sound at this point has grown and it's matured, and it's right where it needs to be at for people to get that perfect potent, you know what I'm saying? Debut record for me, so I'm ready to deliver.
Wiz Khalifa, man, that dude, he embodies everything that's going right, you know, for artists, independent artists in the music business. How different you feel like is it to come out today compared to what it was like, you know, years ago?
How different
yeah.
is it?
Internet.
You know what? You know, I was going to say that. I think the difference is a lot of the celebrities now, they make themselves stars.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? As far as going to a record label and they happen to brand and make a star. You know what I mean? It's either you're a star or you're not. You know what I mean? But some people, you know, still have to get with the right
mm-hmm.
people in order to kind of get that light. You know, but now with the internet, people, it's easy to just like make your own video. It's easy to kind of, you know, just make your own noise on the internet. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's a little easier as far as that concern. You know, you don't have to, it doesn't really cost anything to make a video these days.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, that's the biggest thing. And I think that's the biggest outlet for artists nowadays is the internet.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? That is the biggest difference. From, you know.
Now, what is your current situation? You're no longer with Atlantic.
No.
You're no longer with Trackmasters.
No.
What is your current situation?
I'm independent.
You're an independent mm-hmm. artist. Lil Kim's an independent artist.
I'm independent.
Wow, you about to get all the money now, huh?
Yeah, and see, that's just the thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I am a boss. Other people work for a boss. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I write checks. Other people, you know, get checks. Everything you see me doing, and that's been, you know, it's been, it's hard, especially when you're a female, but, you know, I'm maneuvering with my own money and my own relationship, so, you know.
We're going to take another tweet from the audience. If you want to talk with Lil Kim and send her a question direct, it's at MTV Rap Fix. Let's go to our next tweet. What does she think about the current state of hip hop? That's from Dr. Dope Boy West.
What do I think about the current state of hip hop?
You are the current state of hip hop right now.
Oh, really?
That's all everybody's talking about.
Wow, that's big. Really? Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that music is changing, and I think it always changes, and it always changes, put it that way. Mm-hmm. And I think that in order to kind of remain, you know, relevant, you have to be able to reinvent yourself. Mm-hmm. I don't believe in a cap on a person's time limit, like who we were just talking about. They try to put a cap on my career. Mm-hmm. Can never put a cap on my career. You're not God, only God. And trust me, I'm here to do some way bigger things than people think. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That's why I'm still here, you know? You can't put a cap on it. I mean, mm-hmm. you got somebody who, like Rick Ross, who, you know, he's very much a man, and he's making his way, and, you know, it's, the kids love him, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And I think that, you know, that is really one good thing about the state of hip-hop now, is that hip-hop gives so many people chances. It used to be, at one point, it was kind of limited to just certain people they would let in to the membership of hip-hop.
The membership, I like that.
Yeah.
It was kind of a club, and not only did you, it was, you know, gender-based, and it was also region-based.
Right.
Know, like you,
if
people hate when I say this, but you know, I grew up in Oakland. When it was a time you needed to be on the East Coast to benefit for all the different platforms.
Yeah.
That hip hop had to offer. Nothing against the East Coast, but it was just the business was primarily
here.
You know, set up here in on the East Coast.
Until Snoop and Dre came and did the thing.
That's when Death Row came. Yeah. Man, that was a movement. It's before that, the Ruthless Records movement, then the Death Row movement.
Right, and then Ice Cube and everything. So it's like, you know, I think the state of hip hop is, you know, don't get me wrong, you know, a lot of people who may not be as well all the way around talented can mm-hmm. still make their way, but I think it's coming to a point now where you're going to have to really show up.
Yeah.
Like it used to be. Mm-hmm. It was like that before, you know, you had to really show up, show your talent, show you
are. Have skills, right?
Yeah.
I remember you bring up Death Row. That's when, you know, Bad Boy at the same time
mm-hmm.
was had a lock on the game, you know. And I remember the No Way Out tour back in the day. And I remember seeing that, you know, I was in the business working in radio, but I used to like to go as a fan and go in the crowd. And it was just really, it kind of set a precedence that, you know, kind of created the grid for how crews afterwards function.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I got a clip from way back then. Yeah, I got clips all up in my pocket, Kim, and I want to take it way back to the No Way Out tour. Check this
Let
out.
Let me see this.
Never been in at a show where a family just stuck together through the whole show and we just ripped through the whole show. I mean, everybody out there that come out, you know what I'm saying, they do their thing, but when Bad Boy come out, we does our thing. Me and Puffy, you know, that's like my uncle. So we just really just went out there and did everything we could to make it the best show. You will never ever, I don't think in history, see a hip hop show like this. And if you do, you know they jacked Puffy, Lil Kim, 112, Mace the Lock, Lil C's, Black Rob, Junior Mafia, you know they just jacked us. There's a lot of that going around, but we try to like be more creative than other people and try to just do what we can to make our shows hot everywhere we go and everything we do.
Wow. The irony, huh?
I hate that bed.
Bad Boy, you know, that movement meant so much to hip hop at that time. And yeah. I, you know, as a fan, I'll be honest with you, it's, you know, it's, and I'm going to ask you about, you could answer however you choose to, but at that time you guys showed so much camaraderie and family. And, you know, you fast forward now, you know, you hear about the beef and the conflict. And are those things, say, for example, you know, C's is a friend of mine, I'm not going to front, but that's not where this question is coming from, okay? It isn't. Is there ever a chance of reconciling? No?
Next question.
Never be a Junior Mafia album?
Never.
Okay. At all?
Never.
Okay. Are you sure now? Okay.
Never.
What about outside of the business, you two actually coming to peace?
At this point, I would say never.
Okay.
At this point, I would say never. You know, only God directs my life, so I can't say if I would ever speak to him in a way future.
Mm-hmm.
But at this point, no.
Never.
I have not seen a single change in him. You know, I've seen a bunch of talk and a bunch of contradictions, so no.
No. And then, why didn't you sign a Bad Boy back then?
That's an interesting question. Okay. Biggie did bring me to Puffy.
Mm-hmm.
Puffy did not understand how a sexy female rapper, okay, you know, when he says, like, she's too pretty to be rapping. Come on, female rappers don't look like her. They don't rap. You know, what am I supposed to do with her? You know what I mean? And it was funny because Biggie was like, all right, you're going to be mad. And then when he finished my album and he played it for Puffy, Puffy was like, this album, this can't go out without me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how he got on No Time, because No Time was actually the remix for Get Money. It was supposed to be the remix for Get Money.
Okay.
So, you know, instead of that that Amadeus beat,
yeah.
It was supposed to be that No Time beat. But me and Biggie, all of us hated it. Mm-hmm. We were like, nah, that is whack. So Puffy was like, I'm telling y'all, this beat is hot, you know, blah, blah, blah. But I think, you know, Enough came out with the Amadeus beat, and we loved that so much more. So that ended up being Get Money beat, because that was the single we were promoting at the time. But Biggie did bring me to Puffy, and Puffy kind of, he passed up on Junior Mafia, too. He didn't get it.
Damn, that's crazy.
Because he was, passed up, and he didn't get it. He didn't understand what Biggie and were trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
And we all got it, except for him at the time. And then once we blew up, it was like he just, you know, like he do now, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He just jumped on us, and then especially me, because I was one of the members that just blew up. And so he made sure that No Time was my first single with him on it, which I wasn't mad at, because I always looked up to Puffy as a businessman and as a man in the industry who's always, you know, is known for some good things, some great things. So.
He's always groundbreaking, you know, he's always breaking ground, if you will.
Yeah.
How is your communication now? How's your relationship now? Because Diddy obviously works with Nicki.
Mm-hmm.
And how does your relationship work now?
We don't talk.
Mm-hmm.
We don't talk. You know, this is the one thing that I laughed at, like, hysterically, because I remember in one of his interviews, he said, you know, I can't believe, you know, she's mad at me for working with another female artist. Come on, let's get real. How many other female rap artists has he worked with? So many, even at the time when I was, you know, in play with him, and I never would have a problem with that. Come on, like, I can't wait for the day where people really find out who I am.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things will turn around, because people just don't know me. But once they get to know me, they're gonna be like, oh my gosh, the perception is all wrong. But you know, I would never, like, that doesn't make any sense. You know, some of my closest friends in the industry who are rappers, he worked with. And he's been in that situation plenty of times before. I didn't have a problem. The only problem I had with Puffy is that you see this girl taking shots at me, even on your own record, she took a shot at me, which was the Good Morning track.
Good Morning.
Yeah. And you didn't stop that. If this was me years ago, he would have been doing everything if it was somebody he was working with and he had a relationship with and he got money with or whatever, he would be like, that can't go out. You know what I mean? He would try his best to stop it, and he wouldn't really had, you know. But see, Like I mentioned before, Puffy is the most positive, negative person I've ever met.
Positive, negative.
He is. He's very positive. Because if you watch him very closely, he'll say and do something so positive, and then right in the same breath, he'll do something so negative. Mm-hmm. Just watch
That's
him.
That's interesting. And I'm going to watch from this point.
He actually did it this past BET Awards this summer, when that BET Awards, he was like, come on, all of y'all, stop, the hate, and let's just be positive, and this, that, and that. And then right after he said that, he was like, and I'm talking to you, you mother effer, you F you, and you hate it, and this, that, and that. I'm like, wait a minute, didn't you just say, that's Puffy.
Yeah.
That's just how he does, but I'm specifically hurt because, well, I'm not even going to say hurt because, I'm a hustler, so I respect the game.
Yeah.
I respect the game, but I'm bothered by his actions because of the simple fact that I rolled with Puffy to the bitter end, and still would have rolled with him. Puffy never came to see me in prison, not one time. He didn't write me a letter. Mm-hmm. He didn't say, here's a number for Kim to call, not one time. After all the history that we have, not one time. He didn't put no money in my commissary, which that was the least, because I had too much money in my commissary. I didn't need no money. But just the fact that he didn't even try to, reach out or, make sure that I was good or just see my face. But then, because of your little business situations over there with Cash Money and Rick Ross and all of them, you gonna go see Wayne? You... I mean, this is a group, when we were coming up, you had so many things to say, this group, not in a negative, negative, but in a negative positive way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because they were like his competition. We were Bad Boy, they were Cash Money, but he likes friendly competitions, but a lot of times his friendly competitions get very, competitive.
Yeah.
So, Puffy, and what I'm saying about Puffy is that, how dare you? If anything, keep your loyalty to me because I've been there for you. And
like
even
you
after, even after, he didn't come see me. I got letters from Oprah, Tyra, Mark Jacobs.
What did Oprah say?
She sent me three of her favorite books and said, read these for inspiration. I could get y'all the name. Oh my goodness, I put
give
those
the name.
Books
I'll
up
put
in
that up.
Face.
Okay.
Yeah,
right.
And she sent me three of her favorite books and said that they were going to guarantee to bring me inspiration and motivation. And she wrote me a letter in each book, and just was like, Kim, you have so much potential. You are a very, bright young girl. She has so much really good things to say. And it's so funny because I wrote her back, but I was afraid to send her letter to her because all of my letters that I was sending out, if they see it with somebody famous, people would steal them. I think it's like safekeeping, just to keep them. So I didn't send it out. I still have it to this day. I was like, if I ever meet her, I'm going to give it to her still.
You should come back and read it on the air for us.
I would love to.
See it. I'll tell you what I think, because we said we'll keep it 100 with each other.
Mm-hmm.
You seem like you, I sense that there's a lot of people that you feel wronged that surround it. Even your music now, with the Black Friday tape. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But what's the end game for you? Like, at what point, what would you want? What could resolve this with you and Nikki, you think, right now? Is there an end game plan to this?
Money. Money solves everything. Money talk. This is the thing. Like, it's really like, at the end of the day, I did what I had to do, and I'm keep doing what I have to do, and I'm keep doing me. They're the ones who brought this about.
Mm-hmm.
It could have been that simple. But what they did was underestimate me.
Mm-hmm.
They thought I was just gonna sit back and let them do what they were doing. I said, nah, all right. I'm gonna let everybody know. Yeah, I'm on my Hollywood sophisticated, but. I bring it back if I have to. I think that's in life, I can't help it, I'm G'd up from my feet up. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, if I gotta handle some business, I'm gonna handle my business. And I also have to fight for my fans. You know what I mean? What kind of message would that send to my fans if I just said, oh, you know, I'm going to just lay back and just whatever. You know what I mean? Let this girl do what she's doing. And then just, my fans were more fumed than I was. They were the ones like, do you see this? Do you hear this? And I'm like, ah, you know. But at the end of the day, I understood what they were feeling. You know what I mean? My fans feel like they partially created me. And they did. Like, I owe my fans a whole lot.
The Queen Bee Army. You said earlier that, and I'm playing devil's advocate, so, all right? You said earlier that it's just so hard for female artists right now, and not just in the rap game, but in the music business in general. And you two are like the premier female artists, and y'all going at each other, you know? Is that disheartening?
Yeah, because it didn't have to be like that. See, I think that you guys will see at one point, she wanted to be the only one out there, because it's that simple to say, forget what Baby and them doing, I'm going to make this happen. But she kept going. She took it as an opportunity, and she took advantage of the fact that she had a powerful building behind her. See, let's keep that into consideration, too. She has a building behind her. She got money behind her. You know what I mean? I'm by myself. I pat myself on the back for even keep it moving this far. You know what I mean? Without a building behind me. But if I had a building behind me, it would be different.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But, you know, it's like Rocky and the Russian guy that was fighting with that had all this
Drago
machine stuff hooked up to him. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It really is that situation. I'm Rocky, of course, but, you know, at the
funny analogies.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
You're the underdog. Okay, I promise I won't make this all about bad. It's just, you know.
No, it's not. It's something that I'm sure a lot of people would know.
Well, everybody want to know.
Only time is gonna tell that, because at the end of the day, I can't make you understand what happened in that camp when I was over there, and I can't make you or anybody else out there understand that she wants to be the only female out there. Think about it. When I did my album, I did a song and a couple songs with a bunch of females. You don't. She didn't do that. She didn't do that. Only time you see her with other females is with
Rihanna,
another guy, and that's different. I'm talking about rappers. Let's just get it real here. Let's talk about what she does. In her situation, she feels Rihanna's not a threat to her. Rihanna's bad, in my opinion. That's a whole nother cap. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Let's just be real about what's going on here. She wanted to be the only female. Why she didn't invite anyone, you know, all the female? But after this conversation, she probably will, because she listens, trust me, to
I'm
this
sure
day.
I'm sure everybody's listening. Yeah. That's why I want to have you up here to give you an opportunity to
but
talk.
I want you to also see that I still influence that girl to this day. It's not Lil Kim from back in the day. Just give me what I deserve. So yeah, it's gonna take a lot for reconcile, you know, to fix this. Because I tried, and because of that, you know, my personality, my image, my character was a little bit sabotaged. So you got to pay for me having to even go through that, because it didn't have to be like that. For people thinking, you got to pay for people thinking that I was hating on homegirl. Come on now,
How would you pay? Would you? I mean, so you're not. You're not closed to coming to a table, talking it out, and doing business.
Only if money is involved. Because at this point, it's about, you know, feeding me, my family, and everybody else, since they ain't want to break bread. Bottom line.
All right, you got a question for Lil Kim. Tweet us at MTV Rap Fix. Here's our next tweet. It says, in 6 days, it will be 14 years since Biggie was killed. What was the biggest lesson Kimmy has learned from Big?
The biggest lesson that I've learned from Big? Biggie taught me a lot of things I would keep in a sacred place. But, you know, he is the one who basically let me know that somebody's always watching. You know?
Somebody's always watching. What do you mean by that?
Just be careful what you do. You know, be careful of your surroundings. And he did talk to me a lot about that. He He basically, he was like, although, you know, we were in a relationship at one point, he basically was like a big brother and even a father sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if he saw me doing something wrong, he would correct me right then and there, no matter who was around and how he had to talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So, you know, a lot of people looked at him as being very controlling over me, but I guess at times I kind of looked at it like he just really, you know, looked at me as something very delicate. Because I remember one time he told me, he said, I feel like I birthed you. I feel like you're like my daughter sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, you know, I do. You feel like, I feel like you're my father. You're trying to be my father.
I read that you weren't too keen on the movie that portrayed his life, Notorious. What was your thoughts on that? Why was that?
At all. Mm-hmm. I wasn't keen on it at all. Mm-hmm. Not at all. I mean, in my opinion, in my eyes, the movie was like a big spoof.
Mm-hmm.
It was hilarious. Like, are you serious? Are you kidding me? I think, you know, you're going to make a movie about somebody's life. You need, and especially, you know, they needed me to sensationalize the movie. And, you know, it just nerved me every time as well. I said, the movie wasn't about her, it's not about Kim. But how can you say that when you needed me to sensationalize the movie?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Try making that movie without me. There were a lot of people who were very prominent in that man's life that they made the movie without.
Mm-hmm.
So why did you have to have, you know, my consent? Why did you have to?
Mm-hmm.
And the movie went into green light, like it was greenlit. They were shooting all of that, or getting ready to shoot. They just knew that they had my approval until I broke full. And when I broke full, they were like, you know, we gotta fix this problem. But of course, you know, I wasn't trying to fix it. Like, you know, you're gonna start this movie without me having a CISO. So, you know, of course, I sent the dogs on them, sent the lawyers down here.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, of course, you know, it didn't get worked out to the fullest, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't wanna stop a movie based on somebody who was a big part of my life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just wanted to move on. So of course, you know, it had to be legally worked out. But I wasn't happy at the end of the day. But, you know, I already knew that they were gonna somehow take advantage. So I just, you know, went along with it and just was like, okay, let me just get my check and walk away.
Okay. I remember before I actually interviewed Big like a few days. I got to know Big, you know, when they would come. When Craig Mack and him would do the promo tours on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
My brother Terry used to, you know, take him around to different neighborhoods because
mm-hmm.
we did the promotions for it. Plus, I worked on radio,
mm-hmm.
and I got to talk to him just days before, you know, in LA, days before he was killed. But you know, a lot of people ask me, what was it about Big and your experience that you had that you remember mm-hmm. most? And man, I remember Big used to sit in the van and they used to just cap, just go head up, him and Craig Mack and C's
mm-hmm.
and my brother, and just,
yep.
he was one of the funniest dudes.
Hilarious.
Yeah.
And see, that's what they did not show enough of in that
mm-hmm.
movie.
Mm-hmm.
They did not show that part. They didn't show a lot of his friends that, you know, were responsible for his career. You know,
mm-hmm.
this one guy named Oli that he really, you know, had a lot of, you know, one of the songs, you know, The Missing You was one of the verses in there is like about him. It's like, you know, they should have really showed that because he played a prominent part in his hustling years and stuff like that. Even Un and Just and everybody who was around at that those times weren't recognized for their part
uh-huh.
in his life and in our life and everybody. And then, you know, just even with me, like that, it was totally, that's totally not who I am.
Uh-huh.
I could dress any girl up to look like Lil Kim and, you know, sing my songs and act like me. That's the easy part. But uh-huh. we're talking about a movie.
Yeah.
Forget you know, putting on the hits or karaoke.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, you know what I mean?
You gotta write the book.
Yeah,
okay.
I mean, at the end of the day, I just looked at it like, you know, we were owed more than that because, you know, it took blood, sweat, and tears to brand my name,
mm-hmm.
Lil Kim. And for them to taint it and try to destroy it the way they did, you know how hard it's been to convince people that that's not who I am? You know, I get people come up to me, oh girl, I saw the movie. And oh my goodness, girl, I didn't know. You didn't know what?
Like, yeah. I mean, the role. Okay, so you're saying you not like that, the way Notori played that role?
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, okay, man. I was getting fantasies off that role. I'm messing with you. We'll talk more about that.
Trust me, way better than that.
Well, way better. Okay, that's the Kim I want to know. All right, now, just joking. We're going to do this segment like you are, like you have been when you came up. There are a lot of artists who are independent, unsigned, that we like to give an opportunity to get a chance to shine on Rap Fix and also get advice from, you know, the A-list artists like yourself. So we got a segment we call Get in the Game. Mm-hmm. Artists sending videotapes of them performing, mm-hmm. not professionally done necessarily. They send it to your.mtv.com. And I want to show you this week's artist. Her name is Chrissy, and she's from the Bay. This is Get in the Game.
Okay.
What's up? This your girl Drea with the Team Backpack Cypher, produced by JN.
TeamBackpack.net.
Chrissy. Okay. I'm a bad bitch. Oh, what? You ain't know? Give me a stack. I'll bring it back and make it plenty more. See, I ain't got a hoe. They disrespect the swag. You disrespect. I had you leaking like a maxi pad. I'm getting money while you scrolling down my timeline. You little maggots better pray if you could ever fly. And this real, mommy, I don't really play around. I put the metal to your tummy like an ultrasound. But let me calm down, let me catch my breath. Every time I see your man, yeah, he break his neck. And I don't mean no disrespect, but I'm the f***ing best. These d***s think that competition, they a f***ing mess. I eat bitches, real talk, no homo. And all you haters just give me more promo. You think you f***ing with me? You a dumb hoe. I have them sicker than 3-4 locos.
All right, that's Get in the Game. That's Chrissy. All right, Lil Kim. Think about it. I got Chrissy on Skype right now, too.
Love her.
All right, you love her? Let's bring her up on Skype. Chrissy, what's up?
Hey, Slay.
Hi, Chrissy. Can she see me?
Hi, Mama.
Where am I? Where am I looking
at? You can just look at
her. Oh, hi, Chrissy.
Hey.
Hi, baby.
Hi, Mama.
Dope. Hot. I love you.
Thank you.
Love you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Now, the reason why I picked Chrissy, because Chrissy's from, she's from where I'm from, first of all, the Bay Area. You know,
really?
And in the Bay Area, you got a lot of diversity in terms of music in general, got a rich music history. So I saw this Team Backpack Cypher sessions that they do, teambackpack.net, and they got a lot of young Bay Area artists. And I personally just felt like her, like you, her energy, you know what I mean? She bossed up on the mic, you know. What advice would you give her?
I would just say, you know, do you. You know what I mean? And just keep doing what you're doing, because if you got recognized this far, you know, you're not doing nothing wrong. I wouldn't try to fix nothing, you know? Nothing is broke, you know? Just keep doing what you're doing.
Definitely.
Do you have any questions for Kim, Chrissy?
What you say, Slay?
Do you have any questions for Kim?
I was just going to basically ask her the same thing you asked her. What's the greatest advice she could give, you know, a young upcoming female MC? And that's basically, you know, do me. That's the best advice you could give me.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Don't change anything. You're dope. Keep going. Don't stop. That's the best. I think that's the biggest advice I can give any female, because it gets hard in the industry. And a lot of times females want to just give up, you know what I mean? But don't.
All right, Chris, you got a Twitter account people could reach you at?
Definitely. Follow me, Kiss Begins with K. That's Wit, not with the H. And yeah, holla at me.
Okay, we'll post that up. I didn't really hear you, but we're going to post that up, okay?
Okay.
All right, Chrissy, give a round of applause. So,
Get
the Game artist.
Thank you for having me.
TeamBackpack.net. Got a little fan club in the back. What is that? That's your crew?
That is hilarious.
Those your dancers? All right, cool. Thank you, Chrissy.
That is hilarious.
I'll see you in the Bay, all right? That's what's up.
I love your team.
That's crazy, right?
Hilarious.
When is the mixtape officially coming out? Because people went to PayPal or something and they said they bought, you know, they paid to buy the mixtape, didn't actually get the music.
Yeah.
What's the status?
You know, it's out. And that's a whole Fendi question. And he'll tell you, you know, everything that you can tell everybody. But trust me, we got some treats for all the fans. They're going to be so happy.
Mm-hmm.
And we even got, can I get one of those t-shirts?
Let's throw one of those t-shirts.
You don't have it? Oh, I'm going to beat you, Noel.
And where's Fendi?
Well, I have it.
Oh, he does have it on. Can he come?
Fendi, come see the
T-shirts. Here's some of the T-shirts that they're going to see that the fans will receive, too.
Okay, great. Cover that F up for me. Cover your F when you walk out here. Thank you. Cover the F up. And then stand right here.
He's in here.
Yeah, okay. And then Fendi, come here, man. Come here.
Fendi,
come on, man.
Come over here, Fendi.
I just want to ask you a quick question.
Listen,
that's
all my
the T-shirt, okay. And when people want to order that shirt, what can they do it?
Well, they're gonna get this shirt.
Okay.
They call when they get on PayPal, they're gonna get this shirt along with a poster.
Okay, with a poster.
Yeah, of the Black Friday.
The album. Okay. Yeah. Let me get. Thank you, man. You're a great model.
All right, real
quick, Fendi. Man, what questions can I ask you?
Yeah. Huh.
Mm-hmm. Loyalty is royalty. Yeah.
This is interesting, and I have to bring it up because you're sitting on this couch. You know, you actually worked with Nicki, right?
I started Nicki's whole career.
Okay, you started her whole career.
Absolutely.
And then, this is the incestuous thing that goes, because now Nicki's with Puff, and you worked with Puff in the beginning of your career, and now you're with Kim.
Yeah, I'm the new Puff.
What's the plan? Like Black Friday obviously is a it's her coming back out, but also, you know, it's also her getting that.
Nah, it's not even about that. It's not even about Nicki.
Okay.
Black Friday is just Kim making a reentrance, but basically clearing the way for all the buffoonery that was going on for the last couple of. Since I left the situation.
Okay.
A lot of emulation going on.
It's a great album to see Nicki and Kim team up and do something in the future.
Nah, not no time soon.
No time soon.
Without the check, right?
Nah, I meant the check will work it out, but we about loyalty, so if we sit at the table and we might come to an agreement, her loyalty might just change your whole attitude when we get to the studio.
Okay.
Feel me?
Okay, all right.
Maybe in paper, it was in real paperwork, and that don't even work. I had that.
Okay. Fendi, you seem like you another sit down on the couch. I feel like you got a lot. You got a lot to say.
I'm real about it.
Okay. And I know all of those people too, and I've had the opportunity to sit and talk with them, not about this, you know. And I purposely didn't, and I explained that to you because when we talked earlier in the week, I just felt like it was at the time I talked, it was too soon. And secondly, I don't like to utilize my platforms to perpetuate that sort of thing initially, you know. But it's out there now, you know, and it's heavy. But for you, even beyond all of that, to me, none of this doesn't define who you are and your legacy.
Not at all. But in life, you got it. Something you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
Something you have to stand up for yourself or fall for anything.
Mm-hmm.
Like at the end of the day. I got a major fan base to appease. Mm. I have my Dancing with the Stars Hollywood fans, and then I have my, you know, around the way my hood fans, and I'm not leaving or abandoning neither one of them.
Mm-hmm. So they got to share me. What about your Malibu Barbie fans?
Oh yeah, Malibu. You know what I mean? I mean, Malibu. They see Breeze all summer.
We got a Twitter comment too as well. While you pulling that out your pocket, all right? At MTV Rap Fix, we got Lil Kim on the couch. Let's see what people are saying. I love when Lil' Kim shows her sense of humor, but she keeps that humble spirit with her at all times. That's from Superstar Mike.
Aw, I love you, Superstar Mike. I love you. He's cute.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've seen him.
I think people are happy to see the lighter side of Kim, too. You know.
But I don't understand, because I've always been this way. I don't understand. Mm-hmm. No, you know, I'm just saying, as far as you saying, people are happy to see.
Mm-hmm.
That.
Go ahead, handle that. I can't handle that. That's against the law.
I take it, though. I mean, you know, I hold that for you.
Is it a verse you could kick for us from the album?
It's 20,000. You can do what you want.
But then, it's like, I need to. Thank you.
Okay. I'll let you two have your moment. All right, Kim, the album's out this Friday.
Mm-hmm.
This is our first interview together. I hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you.
All right, I appreciate you coming by here. And I do want to say, like, it's been fun, you know, participating and watching your career, your evolution. And you have always been an artist, even beyond recent years, you have always, as you've seen when we show back this footage, have been an artist to think outside of the box. And and I think you've empowered a lot of female artists and females outside of even the music business by just being brash and being, you know, bold and saying what you feel, whether people agree with it or not.
Right.
You've done you. So continued success to you. And I think a lot of people can actually take a lot away from that mentality and the way you move. And I'm just so surprised that over these years, as many times as I sat down with Big and everybody, you know, over the years, that this is our first time. But I'm glad it finally happened.
I am too.
You know.
So we're going to raffle this off to one of the fans.
Is that what we're doing?
Yeah.
All right, cool. And then.
See what you got me into, right?
That's what I got you into?
Yeah.
And then, so I just want to say thank you for tuning in to Rap Fix. Next week, we got a really big show. Who are we going to be talking to again? Yellow Wolf is coming by next week. Make sure you tune in to Rap Fix next Thursday at 4 p.m. Did you want to say something?
Yes, I want to just make sure that everyone knows at Lil Kim is my Twitter, and I'm verified, so you're going to see the blue V. So anything else is a fraud. So.
How long you been on Twitter?
I've only been on Twitter for like three months now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say.
Exactly.
But there are a lot of people who've been on there since Twitter first started. And because a lot of people are like, Dad, you've been on Twitter for, you know, well, they don't even know how long that I've been on.
You've been on for 2 months now?
I've been on for like 3 months now.
Okay. Well, Kim, thank you for coming by. Make sure you follow me. I'm at Real Sway, okay?
Okay, at Real Sway.
Okay.
I got you.
All right. And,
I'm at Big Fendi.
At Big Fendi.
Make sure you follow me.
Big Fendi? Okay. Yeah. So I don't get a verse. Basically, is what you're saying. I'm not
going to
get a verse.
Hey, what's going on?
This is not your money. This is his money.
I don't want to pay you for a verse. The verse is sell the album.
Okay, yeah, you need to get the mixtape. You got it.
Okay,
there.
Kim, I'm going to let you off the hook. Next time you come, I need a verse, though, okay?
I got you.
Okay, there you go. Lil Kim, give it up for Lil Kim.
About it.
All right. That's it for Rap Fix. Y'all be safe.